Remind yourself of the fact that all beings, as innumerable as spaces vast, are constantly immersed in unspeakable suffering. And then resolve that all of these beings need to be established in the awakened state of initiative Buddhahood. With that aim at heart, with that attitude or with that motivation at heart, you could then set out to continue to listen to the instructions of the profound Dharma as we receive them here. When you now look at earth, stones, mountains, or rocks for that matter, continues Kamachakra, and so forth, all of that will appear just like mist. So having come to this particular point in our practice, we by all means continue to perceive the world around ourselves as it appears. But when we look at all of these different appearances and phenomena, they seem insubstantial. They seem like a haze or like a mist. There doesn't seem to be any substance to them whatsoever. Whether we were to look at, as it says here, the earth itself, or the stones, mountains or rocks, trees for that matter, or the surface of lakes, no matter how it may appear to us, no matter what would appear to us, it would be seen, yet it would be perceived as utterly insubstantial, as translucent, just as a whiff of smoke or a fog for that matter. When fog forms in the forests or mountains, it is clearly visible, yet it has no substantial quality to it whatsoever. This is just exactly how we would perceive things. We would, by all means, as it then says in the next line, perceive them as individually vivid, clear, clearly able to make them out against other such appearances, but we would understand them, we would see them as totally devoid of any essence whatsoever, free of any self-nature, free of any substance in any which way. When mind and space are blended as one, inseparably, it will occur that wherever there is space, there is mind, or there is consciousness. So when looking in this way, and we'll come to see that when it comes down to it, everything is mind. Space is totally pervaded by mind. Mind pervades space. No differentiation, no separation there whatsoever. And therefore, whenever one looks, whenever one merges mind with space as one, the idea could occur that wherever there is space, there is mind, and vice versa. Oh, I forgot a bit about Dharma. I discussed the mind again to that space-like mind. And that is just the case, because wherever there is space, as it says, as it is said, it is no different from Dharmakaya. Mind, for that matter, is no different from Dharmakaya. Dharmakaya manifests in this space-like way. Therefore, wherever there is space, there is mind, and they are Dharmakaya. Everything will be seen as mind, yet mind is devoid of any essence. So once we have arrived at that particular stage in our practice, that particular development in our practice, everything that is perceived in any which way whatsoever is perceived as mind, is perceived as not being different from mind or consciousness, for that matter, in any which way. However, at the same time, we know, we have come to realize at this particular point, that this mind, this consciousness, for that matter, which perceives whatever it is that might be out there, is free of any self-nature onto or out of itself. In this way, whatever it is that might be perceived is perceived as mind. All of this is perceived as empty. And if we had come to this particular point, we would have reached the fruition of the third of the four yogas of the Mahamudra tradition. When we speak about Mahamudra, there are four stages of realization, the first of which is one-pointedness, the second is called non-elaboration, and the third is called one taste. This would be the point of one taste, having arrived as one taste, meaning that everything is of one taste or of one and the same nature, in that it is utterly empty of any self-nature whatsoever. And in this way, whatever it is that we perceive is perceived as nothing other but our own mind and has the same quality, namely that of being empty of any self-nature. Therefore, whatever there is, whatever there might be perceived, is of one and the same taste. And that is, having arrived at this particular point, at the fruition of the third of these four yogas of the Mahamudra tradition, this would be the point at which we could perform all sorts of miraculous deeds, having fully realized how everything is of one and the same taste, meaning how everything is totally empty of self-nature. We could perform miraculous feats, such as leaving footprints in seemingly solid rock, or walking on the water, flying through the skies, whatever it might be. At this particular point, when true realization had occurred, such things would be possible.
Tenga Rinpoche,
Having come to this particular point, having perceived everything to be merely mind, and that mind being utterly empty of any self-nature, one would come to experience this as an emptiness that is nothing whatsoever, as it says in the last line of this verse here on page 278. This exactly corresponds to the perception of beings who are born into one of the four formless realms. The four formless realms are known, the first one as limitless space, the second one as limitless perception or awareness, the third one being nothing whatsoever, and the fourth one is called there yet not there. So having been born among these beings and perceiving the world as such, one would perceive them as the beings who are born in that third of the formless realms, namely experiencing an emptiness that is nothing whatsoever. You may think that there is nothing existent because there isn't a single particle of any kind. And it is also not non-existent, for all kinds of things constantly appear. So one may come to the the recognition or the realization that there is nothing whatsoever. Because if one were to look closely, there is nothing that one could ever find in any which way. Not even the tiniest particle can be found, can be isolated, can be characterized in any which way. There is no such thing. Try as you might, you will not find such a thing. Yet at the same time, it is not the case that it is just nothingness, because that thing which we cannot characterize, which we cannot grasp, which we cannot put the finger on in any which way, is that out of which everything of whatever type appears. And that is exactly the same thing that has been expressed in the aspiration for the realization of Mahamudra by the third Kamapa Ranjan Dorje, in which he says, there is nothing. It is nothing, not even the awakened ones, the victorious ones of the three times, have ever seen it. Yet, it is also not just nothingness, because it is the very basis for everything within samsara and nirvana, for everything within the cycle of suffering, as well as in the going beyond thereof. So there is nothing whatsoever that can be grasped, nothing that we could isolate in any which way and characterize once and for all. Yet, even though there is no such thing, it is also not just a total nothingness, because as we hear here, and as well, also in Kamapa Ranjan Dorje's aspiration, it is the basis for everything that is perceived in any which way whatsoever.
Tawa
You may think that it is neither existent nor non-existent, and as such is one. But if you became fixated upon these fixations, you would go astray into one of the formless realms. So one could by all means come to think that one has got the point now. One could think, indeed, it is not existent. There's nothing that I can put the finger off, that I could put the finger on in any which way. There's nothing that is in any way characterizable. Yet it is also not non-existent. That's it. One could think, by all means, that this is the highest of all views, that one has now finally made the final breakthrough, and that one has understood the highest of all world views that is possibly that one could possibly come to grasp, and simply rest in that. The whole thing, the whole point actually begins already on the last line of the previous page, where the vastness of mind and space inseparable dawns upon us, which is then eventually perceived as nothing whatsoever, as an utter emptiness that, however, is not just a big nothingness, because it is the basis of the thing. Now, if one were to grasp onto that particular view, if one were to fixate upon that viewpoint, then one would eventually make the error of causing oneself to be reborn as one of the beings of one of these four formless realms, because one might think that one definitely has now grasped the highest of all views, whereas that in itself also is not yet really it. Without any certainty that, as it says, that fixates on anything, look openly, free of fixating, at the very essence of whatever occurs. So, at this particular point, one ought to let go of any attempts of characterization whatsoever. Having come to understand that there is nothing to grasp onto whatsoever, even the tiniest attempt of wanting to fixate on something, wanting to characterize, wanting to evaluate in any which way, ceases. One simply rests in this. Whenever one gives rise to this idea, to the idea that this is now whenever the danger arises that one might stray into this view of having found the highest of all world views, Kamachakma then advises us to look openly, without fixating upon anything, at the very essence of whatever occurs, and therefore understand it to be free of any such.
Mm-hmm. ninja or some palm tree does have Nodal Sound, every doctor nearby. That's how you nearby know some Ripak Tenshi Chango. That nearby the young one, Nodal Ti Chang, that Nodal Ti Chang Song, Yang Tenshi Chamba, Chango, what? It is the Tambo thing. That thing is gone to do.
Viewer and that which is viewed merge into one. And that having occurred, there is no more any this is to be viewed and this is the view, or this is the meditation, and this is the one who meditates, or the meditator. This is exactly what, in the terms of beginners, for that matter, we have been we have heard explanations about how the various ways of consciousness appearing to us could possibly occur. We have heard about stillness, appearance, and awareness. And it is exactly that awareness, that consciousness, that familiarizes itself with being either still, free, or devoid of any mental activity, or being active, manifesting mental activity. It eventually dawns upon us that it is that very consciousness itself which familiarizes itself with being conscious of itself. This consciousness which perceives itself either as still at one time, or as active or at the other time, or at the third time as simply conscious of itself. Having come to that point, or that point having eventually dawned upon us, the clear distinction between this is to be viewed and this is the viewer, or this is the view, disintegrates. There is no such clear distinction any longer, and at that point, of course, there also ceases to be a clear separation between that which we define as the meditation and the one who does the
meditating.
No further, this is it, or that is it. Just ordinary. We will come to a point in our practice where we will come to see that no such characterization of any type could possibly hold. There is no further attempt even to qualify or to characterize, to evaluate something or whatever it is that we perceive in our mind natures as this or that. Mind just rests ordinary and eventually actually, then it goes on to say, sometimes you will simply rest in this. Ordinary here at this particular point does not mean ordinary in the sense of confused or deluded. It means mind nature just left as it naturally is, totally uncontrived, without any further ado, without any attempt at characterization, evaluation, quantification, whatsoever. It is the point at which one comes to see that awareness of whatever it is that happens in one's mind stream is no different from that which is being perceived. In terms of beginners, we time and again hear about mind being manifesting or mind nature manifesting either as still or as in movement, and then there is the awareness of either state. Of course, there is that awareness, yet there is no differentiation anymore at this particular point between mind being aware of either of these states. They merge into one, and thus mind rests ordinary, in its ordinary state, ordinary consciousness, which means totally natural, uncontrived consciousness. And once that has come to pass, the verse of Kama Chakra goes on to say, there will come a time when there is no longer anything to be done. There is no longer any drive anymore to do anything about it, to alter anything for that matter. But whatever it is that occurs in whichever way is simply perceived as what it is, for what it is, and left naturally like this, just without any alteration whatsoever. This is the point again where we should train in what we've just heard. Train in simply resting consciously in the nature of things. We would start out as we did in the morning by way of first imagining the teacher above our heads sitting in the lotus sun and moon and receiving from him the four empowerments as previously described by way of the lights that radiate from his three places into our own. After that we would merge our mind stream with that of the enlightened awareness of the teacher and simply rest in that natural uncontrived state. Resting in this state, then eventually a thought will occur, and when such a thought would occur, we proceed just as previously instructed. We're simply aware of the thought, leave it at that, and we'll just continue to rest in the very awareness of whatever it is that may possibly stir within our minds.
drawing or not drawing.